Honors. May it please the Court, my name is Attorney Wendy Overmeyer with the Federal Public Defender on behalf of Gerald Tate, and I'd like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal. I'll watch my time.
Thank you.
For this Court to find that California robbery remains a crime of violence under 4B1.2, it must first find that the commentary interpreting the residual clause has freestanding definitional power. And this exact issue is being conferenced today at the Supreme Court in two different petitions for certiorari from the Third Circuit and the Eleventh Circuit. And so we should hear on Monday whether or not the Supreme Court will take this issue. And I can update the brief, update the Court at that time when they issue their announcement.
Well, what effect would you say this has on us? What do you want us to do?
The pending cert petitions? If the cert petitions are granted, I don't feel it would be prejudicial to wait to Mr. Tate. Mr. Tate has served 18 months so far. The lowest guideline range that we feel would be applicable is 30 to 37 months. So should the case take a year to decide, he would be approaching the low end of that lower range, but he would still be within his time. He wouldn't be serving unnecessary time. That point. The government concedes that Johnson invalidates 4B1.2's residual clause, and that's important here because the commentary offenses that it relies on are linked directly to the residual clause of 4B1.2. They explain and interpret that residual clause, and that residual clause is now gone because of Johnson. And so the commentary explaining that residual clause is also gone in light of Stinson, which says commentary must explain their interpretive portion of the text. And there is no text here. And this is the exact decision the First Circuit came out with in January in Soto Rivera, which was in our 28J letter from last week. And that was once the textual hook or the anchor for this list of commentary offenses, once that anchor is gone, the commentary has no purpose anymore. It's not interpreting any text of the guideline. It's not interpreting.
Soto Rivera addressed only one sentence of the commentary, right?
Soto Rivera dealt with the commentary offenses, the list of commentary offenses, and that's what I'm referring to today as the commentary. There is a lot of commentary to 4B1.2. I'm specifically talking about the offenses that are listed in its explanation of the residual clause. And it found that because the textual hook was gone, that those offenses offenses listed in that commentary could no longer be crimes of violence after Johnson. So the remaining text that we have with 4B1.2, we have the force clause remaining, also called the elements clause. We have the enumerated offenses, and then we determine if a statute is divisible or not. And here we have, recently, this court decided in Dixon that California robbery is not a crime of violence under the similar Armed Career Criminal Act, which, again, only has the force clause and only has the enumerated clause. And Dixon found it was not force. Dixon found it was not extortion, generic extortion. And Dixon found it is not divisible. And so the categorical analysis ends in California robbery.
But the ACCA is different because it doesn't refer, right, to robbery and extortion.
To the having commentary, you mean?
The ACCA.
The ACCA had the force clause, an enumerated clause, and a residual clause, exactly the same as 4B1.2, and the case law was interchangeable as to the two crimes of violence.
But counsel, I thought Becerra made clear that robbery can be that or extortion, right?
Becerra-Lopez, that is the ruling of Becerra-Lopez.
It makes clear that case is still valid.
For 2L1.2 immigration cases.
Which is, I think, virtually identical to the language we're looking at here, is that?
It is not identical to the language here.
How does it differ?
There are several differences between 2L1.2, and our position is that Becerra-Lopez may control 2L1.2 cases, which were not affected by Johnson, because 2L1.2 never had a residual clause. What 2L1.2 did, it said you can enhance for crimes of violence. It did not define crime of violence in the text, as 4B1.2 does. And then 201.2 in its commentary said a crime of violence means a force clause, or it means these enumerated offenses, listing a lot more enumerated offenses than were listed in the enumerated offense text of 4B1.2. So that whole commentary was never in conflict with 201.2's text, and it never had a residual clause. So 201.2 is distinct. And whereas 4B1.2 defined crime of violence in its text itself. And so we are left with just the force and the few enumerated crimes in the text itself. And the commentary to 4B1.2 that explained the residual clause by listing more offenses is now gone because the residual clause is no longer there. And so there's no hook or anchor for that text to explain. And there have been at least two immigration cases in 2013 and 2011 that look at the caution courts and using one type of precedent case law with another crime of violence definition. They say there are at least four different crime of violence definitions through 16B, through 201.2, you have ACCA, you have 4B1.2, and the guidelines could have defined all of those things the same, and they did not. So you need to be very careful, this is according to past panels of this court, in that what a precedent that could qualify under 2L1.2 may not qualify under another crime of violence definition, which is what we have here. With Dixon, it does not qualify. Becerra Lopez, it might qualify under 2L1.2. But we don't have 2L1.2 in this case. We have 4B1.2, which is now almost exactly the same as the ACCA, where you have the force clause and you have the enumerated clause, and that's all that we're left with. And Dixon says California robbery does not qualify under that statute.
You want to save 2 minutes? You want to hit the other issues in this case?
No, I think I'll reserve the rest of my time. I just want to make one more point that this is a very narrow ruling, that the commission has fixed 4B1.2 going forward. They have the new amendment will take place August 16, where it eliminates the residual clause. It changes the commentary to it. So this issue is very narrowly focused to a limited number of defendants that are kind of stuck pre-Johnson sentencing, post-Johnson appeals. And I'll reserve the rest of my time.
Thank you. Peter Levitch for the United States. May it please the court. Your Honor is quite correct. 2K and 2L are virtually identical. In neither guideline does the text of the guideline, the congressional pronouncement, define crime of violence. 2L chooses to do it by listing extortion and robbery, and 2K, the instant guideline, defines it by reference to two things. 4B, which is not an issue here, but it defines it with reference to 4B's listing of extortion only, and 4B1.2's note, which lists extortion and robbery. We know from Becerra Lopez, and we know that in the wake of Dixon's discussion of Becerra Lopez, that Becerra Lopez has continued vitality in its pronouncement that 211 is a categorical crime of violence when both robbery and extortion is committed. There are listed. There is no way, in other words, to find overbreadth. There is no way when robbery and extortion are generically specified to commit 211 without violating either federal generic robbery or federal generic extortion. There is no unwarranted expansion, nor could there be in this instance, because here the guidelines commentary does not expand upon or conflict with the textual definition of crime of violence, because the text of 2K doesn't define it, just like the text of 2L doesn't define it. There's a colorable argument, ultimately, I don't think a winning argument, in the 4B context, that if only the text specifies extortion and the note specifies extortion and robbery, perhaps that's an expansion. Is that a Stinson irreconcilable conflict? I would suggest not. That's not the issue before us.
Could you explain, I'm sorry, but at some point, would you explain how then the cases that are, that the Supreme Court is deciding to, whether or not to take cert on, bear on this case?
Your Honor, I'm unaware that whether or not the Supreme Court grants cert or not in those cases is going to affect at all the continued vitality of Becerra-Lopez. And its
effect. What are those cases?
I believe those are 4B cases. I'm not entirely certain right now. And I know that on May 11th in this court, in a case called the United States v. Andrews, and it's still pending, awaiting a decision by this court, there was a 4B, the commentary unwarrantedly expanded the text case. I think we don't hold this case up for that, because this is 2K and that's 4B.
So we have these cases coming up for, I guess, a cert conference on Monday. If Supreme Court grants cert, your position is, I mean, there's no reason to hold up this case until those cases are decided.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Because our decision in McCarroll would still be valid.
That's as I understand.
Regardless of what they do.
Yes, Your Honor. Becerra-Lopez said when it is categorically a crime of violence when the definition contains extortion and robbery. And as Judge McEwen would say, full stop. Heeding Your Honor's earlier admonition, I would ask if there are any questions for me.
Counsel, thank you very much.
Thank you.
This case is not addressing 2L1.2. This is a case involving 2K2.1 and 4B1.2. So while 2L2.1 continues to define a crime of violence as both extortion and robbery, 4B1.2 no longer does in light of Johnson. Robbery is not one of the enumerated offenses in 4B1.2, unlike it is in 2L1.2. It is not in 4B1.2. And the government has offered no argument today or in its briefing as to how the commentary offenses that explain the residual clause still survive Johnson when the residual clause has been taken out. This is a Stinson issue. There is no residual clause, and the commentary offenses explain the residual clause. And without that anchor to the text, without that link to the text, the commentary itself does not have freestanding power. And the First Circuit, the Fourth, the Fifth, the Sixth, and the Tenth all agree the commentary cannot have freestanding power. The Third and Eleventh, as I said, the issue is going up before the Supreme Court today on conference, and I believe one of them is a 2K1.2 case that referenced over to 4B, and it is addressing robbery in Pennsylvania. So it is precisely on this exact issue today. And so we ask this court to find that the 4B1.2 commentary does not have freestanding definitional power. And therefore, unlike Becerra-Lopez, which still contains extortion and robbery in 2L1.2, 4B1.2 does not. And so California robbery cannot be determined to be a crime of violence for Mr. Tate. And we ask this court to vacate his statutory maximum, 120-month sentence, and remand for resentencing, where without this enhancement, his guideline range will be cut in half.
Thank you very much, counsel.